the evolution of bears, how they survived, then dominate. From the icy Arctic to tropical rainforests, bears have mastered survival in nearly every environment on Earth. Once rulers of the grassy plains, they've adapted to new habitats by transforming their diets in astonishing ways, shifting from carnivores to omnivores, insect eaters, and even full-time herbivores. But what's even more impressive is that these bears, from polar bears and grizzlies to pandas, share a surprisingly close ancestry. How did they evolve so quickly? And how did they survive major environmental changes? Let's find out. Bears are a fascinating group of meat-eating animals that have captured human attention, both in fear and admiration, for centuries. Prehistoric cave art, like the paintings in Chauvet, France, reveals that early humans held bears in high regard, perhaps even as spiritual figures. Norse warriors, like the Berserkers, donned bear skins to summon their fearsome strength, while indigenous cultures in North America saw bears as sacred symbols of courage and healing. But as humans continued to grow, they became a huge threat to creatures in the wild, and overhunting pushed many bear species to the edge of extinction. But in a surprising twist, these fascinating creatures devised new ways to survive, evolve, and thrive. Keep watching as we explore the incredible evolution path to the bears we see today. To begin this fascinating journey, let's start with this pivotal moment in evolution that decided if bears were going to exist or not. In the subtropical forests of Eurasia 23 million years ago, a creature the size of a small dog prowled the underbrush. It was Ursus elmensis, or the bear dog. Though this species lacked the bulk and ferocity of modern bears, it was destined to become the ancestor of one of the world's most iconic family of mammals, the Ursidae. These species thrived during the Miocene epoch. The Miocene epoch is a timeline that spanned from about 23 to 5 million years ago. It was an era in Earth's history that had warm global temperatures and large woodlands. Grasslands spread during this period, and with these grasslands came the rise of large herbivores and their predators. The Miocene also saw the flourishing of forests in Europe, Asia, and North America, which became rich homes for omnivorous creatures like Ursus. Ursus lived in this green paradise with saber-toothed cats, scavenging hyenas, and early herbivorous ungulates. Though fossils of Ursus are relatively few, paleontologists have been able to piece together a general understanding of its characteristics. One of the most significant finds was in Germany, where paleontologists uncovered a well-preserved jawbone attributed to Ursus elmensis, which dated back approximately 20 million years. This discovery provided a critical look into the creature's diet and even its anatomical structure. Ursus was small, likely weighing between 30 and 60 pounds, with a body structure that looked like modern raccoons or foxes. According to drawings, it had an elongated snout and sharp teeth. The shape and wear patterns of Ursus's molars indicate a mixed diet, which further proved they were omnivorous. Its legs were moderately long, and it must have been an adept climber or forager and not a predator. Unlike modern bears, Ursus probably did not rely on brute force. Instead, its survival strategy revolved around exploiting diverse food sources like fruits, small mammals, and even insects. These early feeding habits will serve its descendants well later on, when humans begin to push them to spread across continents. But fossilized teeth and jawbones indicate that they had powerful chewing capabilities early on, which helped them process tough plant matter and crack bones when scavenging. One of the most fascinating aspects of Ursus is its place in the evolutionary tree. Ursus belongs to the order Carnivora, the same group that includes wolves, lions, and hyenas. However, Ursus does not share a direct lineage with dogs, wolves, and foxes. Instead, it represents a branch of the Arctodus superfamily, which includes modern bears, seals, and weasels. This is because the evolutionary split between the ancestors of bears and dogs happened tens of millions of years ago during the Pleistocene and Eocene epochs. In fact, research has shown that some of the earliest bears actually look more like dogs than bears. The lineage of bears that branched away very early in their evolution was called the Hemiscyonidae. These species had to survive in lands that did not have thick forests, and so they ended up evolving and gaining similar features like the wolves we know today. The oldest known species of them was the Hemiscyonidae. It had a long body and probably had a digital-grade foot posture too, which made them stand on their tiptoes just like dogs do now. Their distant cousin, though, bears, walks on the palm of their hands, which means they cannot run for long distances like dogs can. But they can definitely have more functional pores that help them dig better and forage for foods like insects, roots, vegetables, or honey more efficiently than dogs can. Unfortunately, as the Miocene epoch progressed and climates shifted, the Ursivus faced new problems, shrinking forests, and the arrival of larger predators. Slowly, these bear forms evolved into other carnivorous forms. As it is now known, the bears that are carnivores all descended from a carnivorous ancestor about 60 million years ago, which is why so many of them are carnivorous. One of the fascinating milestones in their evolution is the rise of this family we are about to discuss. The Ursidae family. These species began their evolutionary journey roughly 20 million years ago, and over time, they became three distinct subfamilies. Ailuropodinae, best known for its sole surviving member, the giant panda, Tremarctinae, the lineage of short-faced bears and the modern spectacled bear, and Ursinae, the group that includes most modern bears like brown bears, polar bears, and black bears. Now let's look at Ailuropodinae, or giant pandas. Giant pandas came from other bears about 19 million years ago, making them one of the oldest bear lineages. While other bears evolved as omnivores or carnivores, pandas took an unexpected turn towards a herbivorous diet. Bamboo makes up 99% of its diet, which is quite surprising given its carnivorous history. Their digestive system is better suited for meat, so these pandas have to consume massive quantities of bamboo, up to 40 pounds daily, to meet their energy needs. One of the evolutionary adaptations that help their feeding is the pseudo-thumb. This thumb is an enlarged wrist bone that helps them grasp bamboo. However, this new diet also makes them highly vulnerable to suffer from habitat loss, especially since bamboo forests constantly dwindle with human activities. Arctodus, or the short-faced bear. One of the most iconic members of the Tremarctinae subfamily was Arctodus simus, or the short-faced bear. This bear towered at 11 feet when standing on its hind legs and weighed up to 2,000 pounds. They were among the largest terrestrial carnivores of their time, and they dominated the Pleistocene epoch. With its massive size and powerful jaws, Arctodus was a scavenger. It intimidated smaller predators and feasted on their carcasses. This is how it survived for thousands of years. During the Ice Age, Arctodus thrived in an environment rich with mammoths and giant sloths. However, its reign ended when the changing climate and the decline of large prey made it extinct. Of course, the competition with humans and other bear species, like the smaller and more adaptable black and brown bears, did not help its fate. While Arctodus became extinct, another member of the Tremarctinae subfamily lived on, the spectacled bear, or Tremarcus ornatus. These species are native to South America and can be identified by their unique facial features, which often resemble spectacles. They have successfully carved out a niche in the rugged terrain of the Andes Mountains, from Venezuela to Bolivia, and their survival can be attributed to their highly adaptable diet. Unlike their Ice Age cousins, they are predominantly herbivorous. They eat fruits and even cactus. However, they are opportunistic feeders and will even eat small animals when available. Their arboreal habits also contribute to their resilience, as they are excellent tree climbers. The brown bear, or Ursus arctos, and polar bears. The evolutionary story of the brown bear, Ursus arctos, begins about 1.2 million years ago during the Pleistocene epoch, and they descended from the Eurasian cave bear. Brown bears are now found in North America, Europe, and even Asia. They are omnivorous, and they have the ability to eat everything from salmon and berries to carrion and insects. They can also hibernate through harsh winters. Well, at first glance, polar bears, or Ursus maritimus, might seem like a species entirely separate from brown bears, but biology tells a different story. Approximately 500,000 years ago, a group of brown bears became lost in the Arctic. They were never found, but they soon adapted to that harsh environment, giving rise to the polar bear. These bears are marvels of evolutionary engineering. Their white fur camouflages them against the snow, while their thick layer of blubber insulates them from the cold. Even their paws are specially adapted with rough pads and long claws that provide traction on ice. Unlike their omnivorous cousins, polar bears are hyper-carnivorous and they rely almost exclusively on seals. Their long necks and streamlined bodies make them excellent swimmers, capable of traveling great distances to hunt. Now, let's talk about the black bears. The American black bear, or Ursus americanus, is the most widely distributed bear species in North America. Their survival tactics and intelligence make them one of the most adaptable members of the Ursidae family. They are highly resourceful and have an acute sense of smell. Unlike polar bears or grizzlies, they are less aggressive and more likely to avoid confrontation with humans or predators. Their diets vary. They eat fruits, nuts, insects, and even small mammals. This flexibility has allowed them to coexist with humans better than other bear species. But these are also the bears that raid garbage bins or agricultural crops. Now, you might be wondering, why are bears even deserving of our attention? And the answer to that is far more interesting than more people would typically believe. Bears are very important to the ecosystems they inhabit. They act like seed dispersers and even ecosystem engineers. Mostly, their presence influences everything around them, from plant life to water quality. At the top of the food chain, bears control the populations of other species, particularly herbivores and small predators. This in turn helps to maintain biodiversity and ensures that no single species becomes too dominant. If some animal species become too dominant, we might witness the depletion of more plants. For instance, brown bears, particularly in coastal regions, prey on salmon. This ensures that salmon populations remain balanced and that the fish do not overpopulate local rivers and streams, which could lead to ecological instability. Bears are also important seed dispensers. While they are known for their carnivorous diet, most bear species are omnivorous, and they eat a variety of fruits, berries, and nuts. Most times, these seeds drop far from their original location, and soon, healthy vegetation begins to thrive. This dispersal of seeds helps plant species spread to new areas. For example, black bears in North America are known to consume fruits like blueberries, raspberries, and acorns, and they have been known to unknowingly plant their seeds as they wander in areas that never had those species. Also, some seeds need to be digested before they can successfully germinate, and bear droppings usually solve this problem. In regions like Alaska and British Columbia, the cycle of life and death between bears and salmon greatly helps the ecosystems. Adult salmon mainly travel upstream to spawn and die in the same rivers they were born in. Bears, with their keen sense of smell, are quick to find these dead fish and then eat them in large quantities. This helps clean up the rivers and does something else. They also deposit fish droppings throughout the landscape, and these droppings from carcasses are a gold mine of nutrients. They're rich in nitrogen, phosphorus, and other vital elements that help the surrounding soil. Plants like berry bushes and trees usually thrive in these areas. In turn, these plants become good to herbivores, which are then available as prey for bears, completing the cycle of life. Numerous studies have shown that in areas where bears consume salmon, there is also a corresponding increase in plant growth and animal diversity due to enhanced nutrient cycling. For example, in the Tongass National Forest in Alaska, it has been documented that bear activity surrounding salmon streams promotes the growth of plants. Bears do not only influence their immediate environment, they also control the species that live in it. For instance, brown bears eat smaller predators like coyotes or foxes, and this helps keep these species from overhunting smaller mammals or birds. But there's something I haven't mentioned until now. a time when the ancestors of bears were threatened, a time when all life was threatened. If you like this video, then you should check out this video on spiders versus insects evolution. Feel free to leave your answers in the comments below. Thanks for watching.